The idea of Le Sacre du Printemps came to me while I was still composing the foreword. I had dreamed a scene of pagan ritual in which a chosen sacrificial virgin dances herself to death. This vision was not accompanied by concrete musical ideas, however, and I was soon impregnated with another and purely musical conception that began quickly to develop into, as I thought, a Concertstück for piano and orchestra. This latter piece was the one I started to compose. I had already told Diaghilev about Le Sacre before a visit of his to me in Lausanne at the end of September 1910. But he did not know about Petrushka, which is what I call the Concertstück. Thinking the style of the piano part suggested the Russian puppet. So Diaghilev may have been disappointed not to hear music for, I quote, pagan rites, unquote, and his delight with Petrushka, which he encouraged me to develop into a ballet before undertaking Le Sacre du Printemps. He did not show it. I first became conscious of thematic ideas for Le Sacre in the summer of 1911 in Ustilug, our summer home in Volhynia. Petrushka has been performed in June 1911. The themes were those of Les Augures Printanières, the first dance I was to compose. Reaching Switzerland in the fall, I rented a house in Clarens for my family and began to work. The entire Sacre du Printemps was written in a tiny room of this house, in 8 feet by 8 closet, rather, whose only furniture was a small upright piano, which I kept muted, a table and 2 chairs. I began with the Augure Printanière, as I said, and composed from there to the end of the first part. The prelude was written afterward. The dances of the second part were composed in the order in which they now appear, and composed very quickly too, until the Danse Sacrale, which I could play, but did not at first know how to write. The composition of Le Sacre was completed by the beginning of 1912, and the instrumentation, a mechanical job, largely, since I always compose the instrumentation when I compose the music, took me 4 more months in the late spring. I had pushed myself to finish Le Sacre as I wanted Diaghilev to produce it in the 1912 season. At the end of January, I went to Berlin, where the ballet then was, to discuss the performance with him. I found him in a state of upset about Nijinsky's health. He would talk about Nijinsky by hour, but all he ever said about Le Sacre was that he could not mount it in 1912. He saw my disappointment and tried to console me by inviting me to accompany the ballet to Budapest, London, and he invited me to Venice. I did journey with him to those cities. All three were new to me then, and all three I have loved ever since. But the real reason I accepted the postponement of the Sacre so easily was that I was already beginning to think about Lenos. Incidentally, at this Berlin meeting, Diaghilev encouraged me to use a huge orchestra for Le Sacre, promising that the size of our orchestra would be greatly increased in the following season. I am not sure my orchestra would have been as large otherwise. that the first performance of Le Sacre du Printemps was attended by a scandal must be known to everybody. I was unprepared for the explosion myself. The reactions of the musicians who came to the orchestra rehearsals betrayed no intimation of it. Debussy, who might well have been upset by Le Sacre, was in fact much more upset by the success of it a year later. Nor did the stage spectacle seem likely to precipitate a riot. The dancers had been rehearsing for months. They knew what they were doing, at least. Even so, what they were doing often had nothing to do with the music. Nijinsky would say to me, "I will count to 40 while you play, and we will see where we come out." He could not understand that so we might at some point come out together. This did not mean we had been together on the way. The dancers followed Nijinsky's count, too, rather than the musical count. He spoke Russian, of course. And as Russian numbers above 10 are polysyllabic, 18, for example, Vesemnadzet, in the fast tempo movement, neither he nor they could keep up. At the performance, mild protests against the music could be heard from the beginning. Then, when the curtain opened on a group of knock-kneed and long-breaded Lolitas jumping up and down, Danse des Adolescentes, the storm broke. Cries of "Ta gueule!" came from behind me. I left the hall in a rage. I was sitting on the right near the orchestra, and I remember slamming the door. I have never again been that angry. The music was so familiar to me. I loved it, and I could not understand why people who had not yet heard it wanted to protest in advance. I arrived backstage in a fury. There I saw Degrev switching the house lights on and off in the hope that this might quiet the hall. For the rest of the performance, I stood in the wings behind Nijinsky and holding his jacket while he stood on a chair shouting numbers to the dancers like a coxswain. I remember with more pleasure the first concert performance of Le Sacre the following year, a triumph such as few composers can have known the like. Whether the acclaim of the young people who filled the Casino de Paris was more than a mere reversal of the verdict of bad manners a year before is not for me to say, but it seems to me much more. Incidentally, Saint-Saëns, a sharp little man, I had a good view of him, was present at this performance. I do not know who invented the story that he was present at, but soon walked out of the premiere. Monteux again conducted, and the musical realization was ideal. He had been doubtful about programming Le Sacre in view of the original scandal, but he had had a great success with the concert performance of Petrushka and was proud of his prestige with avant-garde musicians. I argued that Le Sacre was more symphonic, more a concert piece than Petrushka. Let me say here that Monteux never cheapened Le Sacre or looked for his own glory in it, and he was always scrupulously faithful to the music. At the end of the Danse Sacrale, the entire audience stood up and cheered. I came on the stage and hugged Monteux, who was a river of perspiration It was the saltiest hug of my life. A crowd swept backstage. I was hoisted to anonymous shoulders, carried out into the street this way, and up to the Place de la Trinité. A policeman pushed his way to my side in an effort to protect me. It was a policeman Degreff later fixed up in his account of the story. Our little Igor now needs police escorts out of his concerts like a prize fighter. Degreff was verdantly envious of any success of mine outside of his ballet. I have seen only one stage version of Le Sacre since 1913, and that was Degreff's 1921 revival. Music and dancing were better coordinated this time than in 1913. They could hardly have been otherwise, but the choreography by Messin was still too gymnastic and too Delcrosian to please me. I decided then that I prefer Le Sacre as a concert piece. I conducted Le Sacre myself for the first time in 1928 in a recording by English Columbia. My concert debut with it came the following year in Amsterdam with the Concertgebouw, and thereafter I conducted it from time to time in Europe. One of the most memorable to me performances of these years was in the Salle Pleyel in Paris, an official occasion with Raymond Poincaré and Edouard Herriot in the audience. I have conducted Le Sacre only once before in the United States, however, and that was 20 years ago, in 1940 in April. I have twice revised portions of the Sacre, first in 1921 for the Degreff performances, and again in 1943, the Danse Sacrale only, for a performance unrealized by the Boston Symphony Orchestra. The differences between these revisions have been much discussed, so I think they are not well known or even often perceived. In at least two of the dances, the bar lengths were longer in the 1913 original. At that time, I tried to bar according to the phrasing, but by 1921, experience had led me to prefer smaller divisions. A comparison of the Évocation des Ancêtres in the two versions, also I think I possess the only copy of the original, should show the principle of subdivision applied in the later one. The smaller bars did prove more manageable for the conductor and clearer for the orchestra. I also felt that they clarified the scansion of the music. My main purpose in revising the Danse Sacrale was to facilitate performance by means of an easier-to-read unit of beat. But the instrumentation has been somewhat changed, also improved, I think, in many ways. For example, the music of the second group of four horns has been considerably amended in the later version. I was never satisfied with the horn parts. The muted horn note following the five-note trombone solo has been given to the much stronger bass trumpet in this version, too. And the string parts have been, to a great extent, rewritten. Amateurs of the older versions have been disturbed by the fact that the last chord has been changed. I was never content with this chord, however. It was a noise before and is now an aggregation of distinct pitches. But I would go on revising my music forever, were I not too busy composing more of it. And I am still not content with everything in the Sacre. The first violin part in Cortège d'Usage, for example, is badly overbalanced. I was guided by no system whatever in Le Sacre du Printemps. When I think of the music of the other composers of that time who interest me, Berg's music, for example, which is synthetic in the best sense, and Webern's, which is analytic, how much more theoretical it seems than Le Sacre. And these composers belong to and were supported by a great tradition. Very little immediate tradition lies behind the Sacre du Printemps, however, and no theory. I had only my ear to help me. I heard and I wrote what I heard. I am the vessel through which the Sacre passed.